In fact, I noticed today that in a link from the InfoQS tool that Shelley did on JBoss EE6, that she had linked to a study that showed that already, within a year of its release, that CDI is one of the top six most important specifications in the Java EE platform in the eyes of developers, which I think is pretty good movement for such a young specification. Anyway, as I said, I'm going to give you a brief intro to the platform, but then I'm going to spend the majority of our time talking about going through a demo and talking about some of the code, and then we're going to wrap up briefly and then move to questions and answers. So, talking about Java EE6, what were the key goals of Java EE6? There were a number of goals, and I'm going to run through them very briefly now. The first of them was to allow the platform to become more extensible. One of the big problems with Java EE was it was very monolithic, and it was very hard to add third-party libraries to it. In other words, what I mean is, of course, you could deploy a library to it, but you couldn't provide any hooks into the application lifecycle. As the application started up, you didn't know. The library couldn't react to these events and couldn't integrate very, very easily. This was apparent in a number of ways. As for example, it wasn't very easy to make your code integrate well into the container. But also, it was very hard to actually even get third-party libraries to start. For example, I'm sure everybody remembers having to use WebXML to enable all these different libraries and technologies. So that they could be picked up by your web application, etc. So that was definitely one of the goals. And for example, this is one of the key changes in WebXML, was it became much more friendly for framework and library developers and allowed them to much more easily embed their software into your application and have it interact with the container without you having to do any configuration. The next thing up was profiles. Now, there were two reasons for profiles, in my opinion, there were two reasons we introduced profiles. The first of which is that some of the technologies in Java EE had become a bit old hat, let's say. So there was some stuff like web services, which people still use, but everyone over the last few years has been moving towards using REST for web services rather than SOAP or equivalent-based services. So there were a number of data technologies that possibly didn't need to be supported in new developments, new Java EE developments. There were also, of course, some technologies in the platform, like container managed persistence, which had been completely, or EJB2, which had been completely surpassed by things like EJB3 and JPA. So, of course, if you're coming to this as a new developer and doing sort of greenfield development, you might get confused and think, well, which of these various technologies do I want to use? So here's one reason for introducing profiles, which allows us to cut out some of the dead wood and focus a profile, which is really good for new developers and new developments. And secondly, of course, some of the stuff in the Java EE platform was regarded as unnecessary for probably the biggest use case that people use this sort of technology for, which is developing web applications. Something like JNS or something like JCA possibly isn't needed when you're building a web application. And so defining a web profile, which is a subset of those technologies, which is very suitable for developing web applications, made a lot of sense. And so out of all of this, we ended up with one profile, the web profile, whose key focus, in my opinion, is greenfield development for web applications. And this is reflected in the technologies includes things like EJB Lite, JPA, CDI, JSF, but doesn't necessarily include things like JCA or JMS. Some vendors may choose to include those technologies, and JBoss EE6, which is a web profile implementation of Java EE, does include a number of these technologies. For example, it does include JCA and it does include JMS, because we feel that these don't add any additional burden to your application if they don't start up unless you need them, but are very useful technologies to have around if you do want them. There are also a number of technologies that were pruned in Java EE6. Now, I still don't personally understand exactly what pruned means, whether it means that these will be removed in future revisions of Java EE, so whether these are deprecated and ready for removal, or whether we're marking them like this so that people don't use them in new developments. And of course, there were a number of areas that the community had identified as lacking, where there needed to be technology improvements. And these are things like CDI, which is what we're going to focus on today, and for example, JAX-RS, which is the RESTful web services offering in Java EE6, as well as some more minor improvements to other existing technologies like EJB and JSF. So, starting to dig a little more deep into what's in Java EE6, if we first of all talk about some of the new specifications in Java EE, there are four of these. The first one of which is managed beams. The idea behind managed beams is to provide a foundation, a foundational set of services. They're probably used more by people developing extensions for the platform rather than end developers developing applications. The idea here is that every technology or every modern technology in the Java EE platform wants to take advantage of some services like injection, like interception, every single specification like CDI, like EJB, like JAX-RS has defined various versions of this. So we need some way of aligning it and providing a common core on which these technologies can build their component models and build the overall component model of Java EE. And managed beams is this. It defines basic services like injection and interception and explains how they look, what they look like, and how they can be extended to provide a user-facing API via other technologies like CDI or JAX-RS. CDI, context and dependency injection, is one of the key improvements in Java EE6. Of course, in my opinion, it's the key improvement. And we're going to talk a lot more about that today, so I won't go into too much depth about that just now. Beam validation, very important specification. I'm going to very briefly explain the motivation for this, and I think everyone can see immediately why it's useful. The idea here is that in a situation without something like beam validation, when you write your application, you of course need to validate the data as it goes into every layer of the database, every layer of your application. For example, you need to validate it as it goes into the database because that's your absolute key thing that you must keep well-structured and well-built. So you need to make sure that bad data doesn't get in there. So you put your validations into your database. You then perhaps use JPA as a persistence layer. And again, of course, you don't want to have bad data passed into the persistence layer at all. So you put some validations in there. And you can see where I'm going. You have to put some more into your application layer because perhaps you have multiple ways of using your application logic, for example, via web services or via JSF for a web UI. And then, of course, you need to end up putting them in your web layer as well, or your UI layer as well, your interface layer, because you need to do that validation there so it's as close to the user as possible so you can give them good error messages. Now, what I've ended up doing when I do this is defining my validation in many different places, which is not really very good because when you come to update the application, you have to remember to go through each section and update the constraint in each section. What beam validation allows you to do is solve this problem, and the way it does it is you place annotations on your entities, on your domain model, and then from there those annotations are applied through the Java EE stack into the database, used by JPA to enforce constraints inside JPA, and can also be automatically enforced in a UI layer like JSF, and we'll see that running in the example later on. JAX-RS, web services, were another key enhancement for Java EE. I'm not going to explain about too much about detail about this today. I'm pretty sure we've had or will have another webinar all about JAX-RS, so I would suggest going to that to learn all about it. Needless to say, of course, it is very well integrated with CDI and with the programming model we're going to look at today, so you can inject things into your JAX-RS services, etc. They put a lot of work into making sure those two specifications work well together. Of course, there are also some updates to Java EE. For example, as I said in the preamble, Servlet 3.0, the key focus here is on easier configuration, so for example, allowing you not to have to configure everything inside your application's web XML, allowing for much greater extensibility. JPA 2, There are two main changes in JPA 2. First of all, if you use JPA 1, you probably ended up using all the JPA annotations and then realizing you need to do some extra ORM, some extra mappings that you couldn't do using JPA, so you ended up using something like Hibernate's annotations to add this. So what JPA 2 does is move a lot of these mappings back into the specification and specify these mappings so that you don't end up having to use annotations from elsewhere. It also added a type-safe criteria API, and I think we're going to have a quick, if we've got time at least, we'll have a look at that in the demo today. EJB 3.1 focused on things like usability, so for example adding an embedded container, adding, which is really good for testing, adding no interface views to make prototyping an application easier and quicker. It added and the key change that it added here was that you no longer have to use an EE6 structure to deploy your EJBs. You can now deploy your EJBs directly inside of Muir, which is a massive improvement for usability because suddenly the packaging structure for all of this becomes considerably simpler. And we're going to see that today. We use lots of EJBs just inside of Muir, so that works very well. Real improvement. JSF 2. Lots to say about JSF 2. It added a foundational AJAX support, much better component creation, changes towards making URLs much more bookmarkable, things like templating from facelifts was brought in. So lots and lots of changes here. Not really the focus of this presentation, so I'm not going to go into any more depth. I've talked a lot about the web profile already, but just to recap, it includes options for persistence, for building your component model, and for building your presentation layer. So, very tightly focused on building web applications. So, I've talked a bit about CDI and sort of talked around the subject a bit, but we're going to see a lot of CDI. So, I wanted to introduce some of the essential ingredients of CDI. The goals of CDI were to allow you to build applications more easily inside the Java EE platform, focusing on giving you looser coupling between your pieces of business logic. And a key way to do this is via dependency injection, and specifically contextual dependency injection. The applications you work with, in where applications and other applications are inherently contextual. You're often storing information about the user in the session or something in the application scope, or you're building stateless services, or you're working inside the current request. So that's where the context of CDI comes in, the idea being that the dependency injection that CDI offers is contextually aware, so that when you inject something, you're injecting from a particular context. So in other words, if you inject from the session, whilst the same session is being used, you'd always get the same object back. Now, how do we do this dependency injection? A lot of dependency injection schemes that we've seen, like Spring 2, like Seam 2, used variable name strings to identify different beans. So, for example, you use a name put on the bean, and then the value of the field name that you're injecting into, for example, to match from the injection point, the field, back to the bean to inject. Now, CDI wanted to do something a bit more type safe, a bit easier, a bit more in keeping with the way Java works, Java being a strongly typed language. And so it uses the bean type, or the class, or the interface type, or whatever, to determine what, to link the injection point to the bean to inject. So for example, say we have a shop and we want to inject the cash register into the shop, so we can keep track of money being spent and taken in. In this case, you could inject by the type, for example, the cash register type. Now, of course, sometimes you end up with a situation where that type alone is not sufficient to identify what bean to inject. In the example I've just given, perhaps you use two different systems for keeping track of checks and cash. So you have some sort of money tracking device, and you inject it. Now you've got two different options. Now at development time, which one you want to inject, because for example you have a process check and a process cache method and you need different ones for different things, but they share the same interface because you're still processing money through them. And in this case you can use qualifiers to distinguish between which bean to inject. And a qualifier is simply an annotation that is used to annotate both the injection point, or the field in the example I've just given, and the bean you are injecting. As I mentioned, this is all contextual, so we need to identify for a bean what scope it lives in, so we need to use an annotation to identify whether it's request scoped or application scoped, for example. And I also mentioned, as I mentioned, that qualifiers allow you to select between different bean types at development time when you know sort of up front which version of a bean you want to inject. Sometimes you don't know up front what version of a bean you want to inject. Sometimes you only know this when you actually deploy the application and you don't want to recompile your source code into binary form. And the key example of this is if you're doing some sort of mock testing, you know, you want to generate your jars, keep the binaries the same, and then run tests against them. And you want to be able to enable different versions of the bean for use inside your tests. For example, you might enable some sort of mock, in the example I gave of a payment system, perhaps you use a web service to validate your credit card transactions. Obviously, in a test, you wouldn't actually want to call out to the real credit card service. You would want to install an alternative implementation of that bean that processes and sends off credit card checks into your system, so that could just respond and give the correct answer based on some other logic other than whether the credit card is really correct or not. Now, this type safety I've talked about is very useful most of the time, but sometimes, of course, you need to interface with non-type safe systems. For example, if you're dealing with HTML or if you're dealing with XML, in this case, a name for the bean is very useful. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this little bit, one of the key goals of CDI was to make your code more loosely coupled. And dependency injection does do this pretty well, but sometimes you want to actually remove orthogonal concerns from the code entirely. And interceptors are one way of doing this. If you've used AOP, they're very like sort of AOP, easy to use AOP. Interceptors are great for extracting out technical concerns from your code. Decorators are a more new concept than interceptors, and they're really good for extracting business concerns from your code. And finally, of course, you need to implement all of the business logic that you're using this wonderful CDI system to wire together. And the final thing that CDI has, which I haven't put on this list, is an event bus. Now, this again plays into this story about giving you loose coupling. Sometimes interceptors, decorators, and dependency injection aren't loose enough. Sometimes you just want to fire off an event, and any other bean in the system can listen to that event and observe it and react to that event happening. And so we have a type-safe event bus that gives you that. I've talked about EJB 3.1, so we won't go into any more detail on that. In fact, I really want to move straight on to the demo, as I know that time is pressing on. The demo we are going to look at today is based around the idea of a paste bin, and you can submit new paste codes, etc., into the system and review them and have them highlighted and things. So I'm just going to briefly switch over to sharing my desktop, and we can take a quick look at the application. Now, I think this is a sort of type of application that pretty much everyone is familiar with. I've got the application up here. In fact, before we take a look at the application, I just need to start it in Eclipse. So I have here Eclipse with JBoss tools installed. I've set up JBoss AS6 final, which incidentally was released about a week ago, and as I said, implements the Java EE web profile specification. I've got it set up in JBoss tools. I'm just going to start it up. And if we look back at the service tab, we can see I've already deployed the application and a data source for the application to the app server, which means that once it starts up, we should see the application getting deployed in just a moment, and be ready for us to use in just a moment. So we go back to Firefox, and we'll load up the application. There we are, and it's ready to go now. So we can write some page code, for example, and we can give it a description. And we can say this is Java. We can submit it, and we can see we get a new page code. We've got different themes that we can select based on various popular themes from the internet. excuse me. If we go back to the homepage, we can see that our paste appears in the list of pastes already posted, I should say, in the top right there. I can do things like submit private paste code. So this time, let's submit a new. Let's submit a. Well, we can submit a different class. Like this, and we can put in a date field to say when it is. Again, we can say it's Java, and we could submit that. And this time around, rather than using a simple numeric ID to identify the pastecode, it's used a hash up there, so that it should be a private pastecode is the idea. And we can also do things like browse the history of the pastes. We can do a quick search. So Martin, who wrote the application, has written lots of paste code, so I can search for Martin. And I believe he wrote some pastes in Java, so I select Java, hit search, and it gives me the various paste codes that Martin's done in Java. We can also click on the link, click on download, which gives us the source code file to download onto our computer. Now, the reason I've walked you through this rather trivial application is just so that when we switch over to Eclipse just now and take a look through the code, you've got an idea of what the various functions that we look at, how the user interacts with them. Okay, so this application, I should say, is available in the Weld bundle. The Weld distribution bundle, you can get that by going to themeframework.org/Weld. Hitting the downloads link and downloading the distribution zip. It's then in example/JSS/pastecode. You can import it into Eclipse. It's a Maven project, so you can just import it using into Eclipse. And then you can deploy it to the app server, etc., as you see. Anyway, taking a look at some of the code, we need to look in the model directory to start with. And we can see that there are two model elements to this application. First of all, we've got, of course, the language in which the snippet is written. This is something we need to store alongside the fragment when it's saved to the database, of course, because we need to use that to do the syntax highlighting later on. So to represent the language, this is a closed set. So I've decided, because we already know how to syntax highlight a closed set of things, we'd have to write additional JavaScript to do syntax highlighting for other languages. I've used an enumeration to represent it. And this enumeration has three fields. It has the extension of the file, so that's useful for downloading. It has a human readable name, and then it has the palette or the brush that the JavaScript is going to use when displaying it. And we also have a code fragment. This is the key entity that that we use for pretty much everything to store the paste code. As you can see, it's a JPA entity. We've got a variety of fields. We also use some beam validation here. Here I'm saying the minimum size for the paste code must be one character, otherwise we're going to display an error. And we'll see that in action and how that links through to JSF in just a minute. We've then got a bunch of getters and setters, and we've also got this function that allows us to compute a friendly date. As you saw, it said, for example, the paste code had been posted just now, or it would say 2 days ago or something like this. So that just generates that, and then a few more bus get and setters. So moving on to some of the CDI aspects of this bit, of this application, I should say, we have a number of beams, and we're going to start with some fairly simple functionality. And for that, we can just use managed beams. We don't need to use EJBs or anything like this. These are just Java classes that become CDI managed beams. So to start with, we're going to look at the paste window class. And you can imagine this is a bit like a view controller class. It's the class that sits there behind the JSF view and performs various operations for you. So for example, if we take a look at this class, we can see it has a name. This means we can use it from in JSF, which is a non-type safe system. It's placed in request scope. This was a design decision that we made, that a paste doesn't need to be redisplayed on a second request or anything like that. So once you've submitted your paste, it's either stored in the database, or if there's an error, it's just stored in the database, I'm sorry. We then, of course, need to be able to inject a bean, which can actually do the real work, for example, persisting this information to the database. So to do that, we inject the code fragment manager. Now, if you remember when I was talking about the CDI ingredients, I said that the way CDI works, when it determines what bean to inject, is by using the type. And here we can see that the code fragment manager is the type of the bean that we're going to inject. Now, there is only one implementation of code fragment manager in our system, so therefore we don't need to use a qualifier to disambiguate what to inject into this injection point. We then got various methods like send, that's hit called when we hit submit button, and it adds the resident code fragment. We then got getters and setters for the code fragment, so that we can retrieve that on the JSF page and put new information into it, and then the ability to display the theme and other getters and setters like that. So if we now switch over to the XHTML file, which is displaying all the information to us on the screen, which is located in the web app directory here. This is a standard Maven layout for a project, and we can open it up and enlarge it. We can see that we've got a template, so we're using the templating from JSF, and inside our main area, in other words, we've defined the menus, etc., elsewhere, which are going to be common to every page, we have the ability to define an input area, which binds to the paste window controller, and then to the code fragment, getter, and setter that we looked at in that class, and then to the text element, or the text field on that. We've then got a drop-down to allow us to select the language, a drop-down to allow us to select private or public, the ability to enter the name that you want to submit rather than having it sent anonymously, and then, of course, the ability to send the to send or submit the information. We also have, for example, the ability to include different write menus into our application, and to do that, we include this write menu default, which is the default right-hand menu to use. So let's have a look at how we display some of this information on the page using CDI beams. The first thing we're going to look at is how do we display the language, the programming language, that we're going to use. Now, as I showed you, language is an enumeration. JSF, in its native form, can't understand enumerations. It can only understand, for drop-downs, it can only understand arrays and collections. So what I do here is simply convert the enumeration into an array. Now, to do this, I use a producer method, and I didn't talk about producer methods when I gave the overview of various things in CDI, so let me do that now. I said that qualifiers allow us to select between implementations of beans at development time, alternatives allow us to do it at deployment time, and producers are what allow us to do it at runtime. So producers allow us to change the implementation of a bean at runtime. The actual bean definition is created up front, which is good. We'll talk about that later on. Why that's good later on. But the actual bean definition is created up front. But we, when the bean is required, when the bean is injected, the method which defines it, or the method which produces it, gets called, which allows us to control what is returned. And here I'm simply using that functionality to allow me to convert from one type to another when it's called. Of course, it also needs a name so that we can access it from JSF. Now, I should talk a little bit about how at named works. At named follows the standard rules defined by the Java bean specification for determining the names give things. So if you put at named on a class, it will drop the case of the first letter and give you a camel case that way. If you put it on the getter and setter method, it will remove the get or the is and drop the lowercase of the first capital, therefore again giving you the property name, as it were. So that's one way of using producer methods, or one way of displaying enumerations in the view layer. Another way, which I use here, which starts to introduce some of the scopes, is via theme manager. And of course, as we had a drop down for languages, we also need one for themes. So I've decided to go for a slightly different approach here, just to demonstrate different ways you can do things. I've said that generating this list of themes is a really heavyweight operation. I mean, of course, it's not really, but you know, for the purposes of this demo, let's pretend it's a very heavyweight operation. And so I only want to do it once in the entire life cycle of the application. So therefore, I define this application scope bean that in its constructor, when it's initialized, performs the heavyweight operation. In this case, it's just converting the array to a list and stores it in a field. We then use the producer method to expose this field as a first class object. Now, this is good because it reduces coupling, because rather than having to reference the theme manager all the time, we simply reference this list of themes. So that's another way you can use producer methods. Okay, so we've taken a look at how some of that information is output, but how do we save this information to the database? So going back to the paste window class, we can take a look inside the code fragment manager, which is providing all of these services. Now, this is where JBoss tool comes in very handy, because as you can see, because this is a CDI project, we've got an extra drop-down menu, so that when I command click on Code Fragment Manager, it asks me whether I actually want to open the declaration of Code Fragment Manager, in this case, the EJB interface, or whether I want to open the implementation. Of course, I actually really want to open the implementation, because that's what we're going to take a look through. So, you know, we can use JBoss tools to open up things like open up the implementing class. Now, I've moved here from using managed beans to using EJBs, and you may be wondering why. And this really goes right to the heart of a key question that people always ask, which is, when should I use EJB, and when should I use CDI, and should I use EJB at all, and other such questions. Now, my answer to this is always, start simple, start with managed beans and CDI, and add EJB as it's needed. So in this case, CDI doesn't define any integration with persistence. It simply defines an injection model. So in this case, we want to use EJB because we want to use things like declarative transactions on our methods, so that when our methods are called, they automatically get given a transaction that is committed, etc. So for that reason, I've decided to make this an EJB by adding state annotation. This bean holds state, so that's why it's stateful rather than stateless. Of course, I can also use things like injection, CDI injection, into the code fragment manager. Now, if we take a look, for example, at the get and add algorithms, the get and add methods, we can see some various logic going on. So, for example, we set the current date time into the code. Normally the code is submitted through the web interface doesn't have a date time field because we want to record the current time. Again, if the user is empty, we set the user to be anonymous because we want to display something other than null. If the fragment is supposed to be private. We compute the hash value for it. Otherwise, we can just use the non-hashed ID that is generated by the database. So that's, that we can just use the ID that's used as the synthetic key for the entity. Now, how do we use this hash computer, which is computing the hash value? Well, again, we can go up to the top of the file where we, where we define these things in just a moment when I get my computer back. So we seem to have a problem with execs. So whilst my computer sorts itself out, I'll continue talking. We can go back up to the hash computer, and we can take a look at it, and we can see, for example, that that this is just another CDI bean that we've injected. Okay, I'm going to have to just kill a clip quickly. And restart it, so just a moment there. Now, something I did briefly want to talk about was this thing about how the CDI model is built up front. Now, this is something that's very, very useful because the way CDI works is all of the bean definitions are defined up front. You can't add and remove stuff on an ad hoc basis from a context. You can only work with well-defined CDI beans. And this is great because it allows us to do things like validate the entire dependency injection graph at startup and make sure that all of the injections are satisfied, thus giving you the errors for the system much earlier. And this is actually something we can even extend into the tooling. And you will see that JBoss Tools offers this inside the tooling. It offers the ability to actually validate your various injection points, etc. And I think we even saw that one of the injection points that we had for some reason was coming up as ambiguous, and I'm not entirely sure why that was, but we can see that there are various validations that that JBoss Tools offers, which are very useful. So just to continue the tour through the code, we were going to have a look Okay, well, we'll just give that a moment, and hopefully we can return to, there we are, so that's good. Okay, so if we can just give me a moment to reset the views, and we'll go into the pastegate example. We were going to take a look at the hash computer. So if we open up where we were, which is the code fragment manager, we see that we can, for example, again, just, go into the hash computer. Now, this time, I've decided to make a hash computer stateless bean, because this is a completely stateless service, and so we're going to take advantage of another service EJB offers, which is stateless pooling. And we don't want to recreate a new version of this class every time, we just want to take advantage of the pooling that EJB offers. So you can see how I'm adding EJB services to classes as I need them. Now, I want to show you, I should explain, I have a very long list of things I can show you with this application, and I can never ever get through all of them in a single hour. It takes about 2 hours to get through the whole lot, so I tend to just pick and choose little bits to show from the big old list that I have. So I'm just trying to choose what to show next, but I think what I'd quite like to show is the event bus. I think that's a really neat feature. So one of the things we wanted to be able to do with the event bus is have some kind of logging with the pastecode application, would have some sort of logging of pastes as they come in. For example, this can be some sort of audit logging or something like this. And so what we decided to do for this simple application is just log on the console when a paste comes in. So if we just, I'll just start the server in the background. The way we decided to do this was use the event bus to do this. It's absolutely perfect for that. So what we do when a paste gets added to the database, we fire fire an event with the paste code as the payload of the event, and we do that here by calling event.fire and passing in the code fragment of the payload. We can take a look at the definition at the top of the class here, where we inject event. Our event is a built-in CDI bean. So what this basically provides is a set of methods that allow you to fire events. Events are type safe in exactly the same way as injection, so we can use qualifiers to disambiguate if we need to. And we can take a look and see how this event is used. Now, this is another advantage of being really type safe, is that we can, for example, use the standard Eclipse tools to search through code bases and look for usage of classes. So we look, for example, for usage of code fragments, and we can take a look and see that it's used in various classes in the session. But I know that what we're going to be doing with this event, when we observe this event, is in a logger, so I guess it's probably this code fragment logger class. Open it up, and you can see that we have an observer method. And again, an observer method is just a method with a parameter that's annotated at observe, and to select which event to use, we put in the payload type code fragment, and then this payload that we pass to fire will in fact get passed in as the argument to this method. This method then adds the fragment to this log that we have up here, which is also accessible with this getter method and can be cleared. Now, of course, we could have lots and lots of people writing to this, and of course this logger is a singleton because we only have a single application log to write out on. So we could have lots and lots of concurrent users adding paste at the same time, which does mean that we could end up with some concurrency issues here. So again, something I've decided to do is use another of the declarative features that EJB3 offers, or EJB3.1 offers, which is declarative concurrency. So I've placed the lock annotation on my various methods to declare the concurrency level I need for those methods, thus allowing EJB to handle all of the concurrency for me. So that's another case where you might want to use EJB on top of CDI to take advantage of some of those services that EJB offers. Now, I mentioned earlier on that one of the nice things about validation was that it's really well integrated into the Java EE stack. So hopefully the application is up again. Oh, no, we've got a problem. I think because Eclipse died, I've got too many JBosses running. So I think if we just kill this, and then I will just kill the other JBoss very quickly. Okay, that should be it. So let's try and start JBoss again. Oh, from Eclipse. And head back to the service tab and start up JBoss. Okay, so while JBoss starts, what I'm going to do is show you the way that, if you remember, I showed you in the model, we have this beam validation annotation at size that says we have to enter some text into the entry field. And what we'll see in the application once it's started is that this message gets displayed. And if you remember, when we looked at the source for home.xhtml, we saw that we didn't see any validation logic in there at all. And in fact, we didn't see even anything to associate this to the validator, because it would have been in this input text area just here. And so what we can actually see is that with no configuration, these validations are automatically applied throughout your application. So if we just go back to the application, I can show you that in action. So we hit new. Oh, we've got a problem now. That's just it's probably resulting of the unclean shutdown. I believe that's probably the unclean shutdown of JBoss. So I'm just going to try and shut it all down. And one more go at starting it up. So, Another thing that I can show you is some of the nice integration into Servlet. I showed you how, right at the beginning in the demo of the application, how we can download the paste code as a text file. We decided to use a servlet for that. So if we take a look in the servlet package, we can see we've got a download servlet. You know, it's a bog standard servlet with a do-get method that just builds the file from the database. But the nice thing here is, if you notice, we can actually inject, we can easily inject you know, CDI objects into our servlet, again, with no configuration. Here's another nice little thing that's been introduced in Servlet 3, the ability to define servlets using annotations. So again, we have a much more consistent programming model across the whole of Java EE, no more fiddling around with your web XML. Now, we can see that this time the application has started fine. So we can just open the application again in Firefox. We've got a problem. Okay, so obviously the something about Eclipse crashing has killed the application, so I obviously haven't killed JBoss properly or something, so I apologize for that. So anyway, you'll just have to take it, well, we saw that we always have to take it on trust, I'm afraid, that the validation is applied. Let me just try one more time. It does seem to sort of be working. What we can see is that that we have this message coming out here that no code fragments have been pasted. This goes back to the eventing system that we were talking about just a minute, the logging system. I showed you how that list is built up, but how do we print it out to the console like this every minute, showing that that fragments have or haven't been pasted? Well, what we've got is we've got a beam, which is this code fragment printer beam. And what this does is it has a method print, and that just simply accesses our code fragment logger, which we've injected, of course, and is using the declarative concurrency, and prints it out to the console. Now, this is a method that's annotated at timeout, which is another declarative service that EJB offers, the ability to have timers built into your application. And of course, because we're using EJB services, we need to make this a stateful or stateless EJB. In this case, it's a stateless service, so I've decided to make it stateless, stateless EJB. And finally, start the timer, I can inject the timer service using the @resource annotation, which is from Java EE5, and just call this create timer method on it, asking it to do something every minute. So now we've got the timer, but how do we start the timer? Well, again, this is another service that EJB offers. It offers the ability to have startup singletons, which are beams that do something when your application starts up after all of your services are initialized. And so we make this a singleton, startup singleton. That's just the EJB way of saying it makes this a beam that starts up when the application is ready to go, but before any user requests are processed. And then we can have a post-construct method. Everyone knows what post-construct does. And we can use the code fragment printer .start timer method to kick the timer off. So that's a sort of tour through a few of the features of CDI. We've jumped around a bit, but I hope that gives you an idea of the power of CDI. Like I say, this application is available to download inside Weld, so I suggest you go and grab it. As I said, you can get Weld from seamframework.org, and you can download Weld 110 Final, which we released recently, which has this application in it. We're just in a moment just going to go back, and I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview of where the where Weld and Java EE and JBoss, etc. are up to, and also talk a little bit about some of the things we're going to be doing in the future with regard to this. So I'm going to briefly switch back to the slide deck. And moving to the next slide, I'm going to just give you a little bit of my opinion of what the Java EE6 story is. As I've been reiterating throughout, the idea is you start really simple with managed beams and CDI in services like injection. As you need to more loosely couple your code, you can add in things like events, interceptors, and decorators. As you need so-called sort of enterprise services like persistence or validation, declarative transactions, you can start to add in things like JPA, beam validation, EJB. We've also looked a little bit about producers and how they can replace factories to give you really good loose coupling. And yeah, as I said, you can use CDI to you know, really get a very loosely coupled application. So what's the availability? This is really nice. This is the first time that I've given this presentation where I can say that JBoss AS6, which of course is my preferred Java EE server, implements the Java EE6 web profile. You can see that this is definitely the first time I've presented this because I even spelled the word profile wrong on this slide. But that's, for me, is a really big milestone. So I do have to say congratulations to the whole of the JBoss AS team. That's a really, really big achievement for everyone. Java EE6, of course, has been final for about a year. And I know that everyone in the EE community is starting to think a little bit about what should be in Java EE7. I think with the goal of Java EE7 going final in around a year and three quarters time, something like that. We've also just released Weld 1.1.0. There were a number of concerns in the mid-autumn, I suppose, about some of the scalability and performance aspects of Weld. I'm really pleased to say that I think we've addressed those, and we also have plans to make it even better. For example, we saw memory usage reduced, I believe, by around something like 4 or 5-fold. We saw runtime performance increased by around 40%, which we've measured to be roughly equivalent to other DI solutions out there and also other CDI implementations, equivalent to or better than, I should say. We've also decreased the bootstrap time in applications with a large number of beams. For example, I think we were profiling up to 10,000 or 20,000 beams, something in that area. And we sort of managed to get the bootstrap time for, you know, pretty much even 10,000 beams, 10,000 classes deployed in your application, down to something, you know, not too ridiculous, say 5 or 10 seconds, something like that. We would like to improve that further. And again, with the memory usage, we were aiming for another sort of 2 or 3-fold improvement in memory usage, at least, in the next release. We really got as far as we could with improving memory usage with the current architecture of Weld. We need to make a few changes to the architecture in order to get those final that final cut down in. Before we move to Q&A, let me just talk a little bit about what's coming in Java EE7. I know that there are plans to update JPA. We definitely have plans to update CDI. One of the exercises I'm going through at the moment is going through all of our old discussions on both the development list for Weld, the forums for Weld, and other discussions that we've had on blogs, etc., to collate all of the issues that people have come across with CDI and putting them into the CDI JIRA on JBoss.org. To allow us to get a clear picture of what we should include in CDI. At the moment, it really looks like there are a number of annoyances to CDI. The primary one that people have identified is that it's to do with enabling interceptors and decorators, and these are things we definitely want to address. But we're not looking at adding any huge new features, you know, more just minor features and trying to iron out a few sort of rough edges with a couple of things that are there. So we're looking at doing a 1.1 release, and again, this will be in the Java EE timeframe, so I think having an early draft later this year and public review draft early next year, followed by the final release in about a year and three quarters time in the autumn of, I guess that makes it the autumn of 2012. So that's kind of where CDI and Java EE 7 are going. I think it's pretty encouraging that there are you know, only sort of relatively minor things to add to CDI. I think it shows that the spec, Gavin did get the spec, Gavin and the expert group did get the spec roughly right the first time around. So with that, I would love to take some questions. If Burr, you have some questions queued up, that would be great.
Yeah, we actually have some great questions already. I'll read a couple of them out to you, and there'll be more coming in as we talk here. One is, Jason noticed that you're using at persistence context as at in on the entity manager. Well, what is the preferred way of handling, you know, the persistence context?
Okay, that's a really good question. I have to admit that I'm probably not using the recommended fashion in this demo application. The recommended approach would be to create an alias, essentially, for your persistence context. Let me show you that very quickly in a code fragment. If we just switch back to Eclipse, and then we'll leave it in Eclipse from there, because I think, you know, that's where we're going to want to be to do all sorts of stuff. So if I just create a new class, we just call that persistence context manager. Okay. So this is just going to be a little alias. The alias is the app persistence context injection across to a CDI injection. So we define it to be a persistence context injection point. So we have to do that. Right, so that's now injected our persistence context. We now need to define a little alias for it, and we can do a special kind of producer field, as I showed producer fields, but we also have producer methods, I'm sorry, in the demo, but we also have producer fields. A standard producer field would simply look a bit like this, and we'll basically just say, you know, it's a much more cut-down version of producer method, and basically says whatever the current field value is when it's accessed, when the producer method is, producer field is called, that's the value of the bean instance. But we can do a special version for Java EE resources where we actually inject using Java EE's 5-style injection using app persistence context or at resource or at EJB into the field, and then immediately produce it back out using a producer field, thus essentially aliasing this into a CDI style injection. So if I then went back to my code fragment manager, which is where I was using this, I could now replace this app system context with app inject like that, and it would all work just the same, and I would now actually be following our own recommendations about how to use entity managers inside CDI.
All right, very good, very good. And another question even related to that is the concept of annotations. This gentleman basically says, I'm a little weary of annotations, sometimes up to 17 lines of annotations in some of his domain objects. Is there a way to do some XML?
Yeah, okay, so there's a couple of, I mean, you know, in your entity objects, obviously CDI doesn't particularly come into play a huge amount there. They tend to be more bean validation or JPA style annotations, both of which are configurable via XML. CDI itself doesn't come with an XML configuration dialect. However, something I haven't talked about, but is a really important part of CDI, is the extensions, the ability to write extensions for CDI. CDI provides a very large facility where you can listen to various events whilst the container is booting and alter the metadata the container has. So, for example, you can listen to, for example, every single class that is defined as a bean, every single producer method, every single producer field, every single event, and you can receive metadata on them. You can then actually change that metadata or even add your own metadata about different classes that aren't included in your application, and then the CDI engine will use that altered metadata, as it were, to define the beans. So what this means is that we can actually write an XML dialog. For example, theme config provides such an XML dialog. And because of this very powerful lifecycle listener stuff, we can use this to write a portable layer that provides XML configuration in any container that implements CDI. So although there isn't an XML configuration layer or dialect built in, there is a fully portable one available. We have often discussed adding one at the specification level. However, there was a desire in the Java EE community to keep the XML descriptors consistent between various specifications, which is, of course, is an admirable thing to do because consistency is very important when you're working with a platform. However, as I'm sure everyone is aware, the Java EE descriptor style is a little bit antiquated now, as all of the descriptors really need, all of the XML descriptors really need a bit of an overhaul and being glossed into a more modern style where they use, more, more attributes in XML, they use XML schema, that kind of thing. So it was felt that at the moment it was better not to introduce an XML dialect for CDI because we couldn't do well in the old style. It was better to delay it until the Java EE schemas were brought into the descriptors, were brought in more into the modern world, and then introduce a CDI XML dialect at that point. So this is definitely something we'll be, or I'll be pursuing at least with the Java EE expert group for Java EE 7 to try and encourage them to bring such a, such update to all the descriptors into specifications so that we can then add, an XML, a modern XML dialect to CDI.
And we actually are way out of time, but we have a number of great questions. Let's try to hit a couple others real quickly. One person wants to know about at lock. Does that kind of work like the synchronized keyword?
Yeah, essentially this provides a system of semaphores declaratively introduced so that it's not exactly like synchronized, because synchronized is all or nothing, either you can have one thread accessing a synchronized block, or only one thread can access a synchronized block at any one time, and all other threads will block at that point. The declarative concurrency in EJB provides different levels of isolation in the same way that your data device provides different levels of isolation. So it's more like, it's a replacement for synchronized, but it's more like the way a database provides locking than the JDK itself, because it provides for both read and write types of locking, so that you can actually have, if you don't have any writers, like in a database, you can have multiple reads going on at the same time, but a write would cause everything else to block. I suspect, I'm not entirely sure, but I suspect you can also configure the scheme you want to use for enforcing your isolation, on an application-wide level.
Okay. Another question I thought was pretty interesting here is does an injected managed beam that in turn injects a transactional resource automatically participate in any existing transactions? And I guess what they're really asking is how does the relationship between a CDI and a transactional EJB, people are kind of curious about that whole interaction there.
Yeah. Okay, so CDI itself doesn't offer any declarative transactions, or doesn't participate in transactions. To do that, you need to use EJBs. So, if you have a managed beam that injects an EJB and the EJB does some work inside a transaction, let's say, and then calls another managed beam which uses that transaction, you will have a transaction running for that managed beam call because, we're inside a declarative transaction for the EJB, and the transaction will be propagated to the managed beam. But you certainly shouldn't design your applications like that because, of course, the managed beam could be called from outside of an EJB, which is using declarative transactions, and therefore you would not have a transaction running inside there. So the best thing to do is to, wherever you need to access transactions, is to use EJBs, because then you are sure you have declarative transaction facilities available for that method that you're working with. So using transactions is a good reason to use EJB. There's a couple of other points that are worth raising here. There are extensions to CDI that provide transactions for managed beams. Seam persistence is the example I know best of this. This provides declarative transactions for managed beams, so you don't need to use EJBs at all. And in this case, it provides some alternative annotations you can use to control the transaction on the managed beam. It will automatically give you a transaction context for managed beam invitations, etc. So, you know, if you want to use managed beams with transactions and don't want to use EJBs, then you can, of course, use Seam persistence to do something like that. The other thing that's worth sort of thinking about briefly here is how this relates to what we're coming up in Java EE7. Something that a lot of people have talked about and a lot of people have thought about is that really, in many ways, a lot of these so-called EJB services should not only be available in EJBs, but should really be much more transparently available across the whole CDI programming model. Now, we are actually 95% of the way there because, you know, EJBs can be packaged in WARs. The EJB container automatically starts when it finds an EJB annotation in your application. So all we're saying is really what we need to do is remove the requirement to have that top-level stateful or stateless annotation, to find some sensible defaults so that if an annotation like a declarative transaction annotation is discovered on your managed beam, then it just makes that beam into a stateful EJB, and away we go. So we just make that usage of EJBs a little bit more transparent. And again, this is definitely something I want to pursue for Java EE7.
Well, Pete, that's fantastic. There are a few more questions, but I'm afraid we're not going to have time for them today. We're several minutes over our hour. But I thank you all very much for sticking with us for this hour. We had well over 300 people this afternoon or this evening or morning, depending on what part of the world you came in from. And I enjoyed watching the hello from your various location. The one that threw me off was Transnistria. I hadn't heard of that country before, but I looked it up and found it out there near Moldova. So welcome for everybody who came in from around the world, and thank you folks from India and from down under. I know you guys are up early in the morning or late at night to attend these sessions. So thank you guys very much, and feel free to get back to us. If you have any questions, you can always email me at bsutter@redhat.com or bird.sutter@jboss.com, and we'll certainly put whatever kinds of information you guys want to see in these sessions on for the next time. Pete, thank you very much for a great presentation.
Thank you.
And everybody have a good day. Thank you very much.